Good morning. We want to welcome you on this Palm Sunday. And the sun is shining, but there's also snow on the ground. Actually, I was thinking about it this morning. Babs two weeks ago said, you know, I think we have one more good snowstorm coming. So she was right. And she's better than the guys on TV. So when Babs gives you a prediction, you better listen. We have a few announcements that we'd like to highlight. This week is the today is the beginning of Holy Week. On Wednesday, we will be showing our final film, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, the original with Sidney Poitier. And it still handles the test of time. A few words that we probably don't use anymore, but it's a good film. And I encourage you to come. It really talks about the acceptance of the other folks who aren't like us, and it's quite inspiring. For those of you who haven't heard through the theological grapevine, and we'll pray for him later, Reverend Lennox Scarlett at Wesley suffered a mild heart attack this past, I think, week and a half. And fortunately, he is at home recovering, but we want to pray for a speedy recovery. And if he's anything like most ministers, and I'm sure he is, we always seem to want to get back before we actually should get back. So also just patience in his healing. So Wednesday is the movie. Monday, Thursday, this week we always move our Lenten meal to Monday, Thursday. And we will have not only a simple meal together, but we will also have a demonstration of the Seder Passover meal and how it relates to our Holy Week. So it's something that would be, again, hopefully inspiring and informative. And then finally, de-escalation training, April 6th. So that's just 2 weeks away. At 10 o'clock, we will be gathering together to learn how to, when you encounter someone who's having some, like a mental episode or drug use, folks who are a little hard to handle on the street, how to de-escalate the situation, what to do, how to be prepared. Because we have a city church, you know we've all experienced this, so this will give us the training that we need. And it's $10. We start the times are a little off here. Door's going to open at 9:30. There'll be coffee, and then we start at 10, and we will conclude at 11:30. So that's 2 weeks from yesterday. Last night, if you were here, you know how much fun it was. I sent out a challenge, and our competitors rose to the challenge. I believe we came in third. I think the choir came in second. Am I right? Yeah. And there was another group that won. So our trivia night. So I think yeah, Marcus yelled at me this morning. I'm giving him no acknowledgement at all.
Team won. And well, the two of them really have a lot in common, believe it or not. And everyone had a great time. We were down in our table numbers from last year, but are we ready for the drum roll? Oh, he's mad he lost. So after our expenses, we made $1,500, $516. Sorry, we got that right now. So we felt we did pretty good. So some of the bids weren't as high as we would have liked, but they did do well on the special VIP pass for the Niagara River Line, so we were really happy with that, and it was such a generous donation. So, and this morning, the cat decided he would sit in the wine box. No, it was empty. He liked the box, and he wanted to sit in that before he ate his breakfast. So anyways, thank you to everyone for coming and all the helpers that we had. We had a really good crew, and it was a great night.
A good time was definitely had by all. As we come together, we continue to pray for peace in the world, peace in our homes, peace in our churches. Peace in our communities, and peace around the world. Let's pray. Oh God, we were saddened this week to hear of the mass shooting in Russia. And as we are reminded, it doesn't matter if we're Ukrainian or Russian or Palestinian or Israeli or Canadian or American. We're all your children. So we pray for peace to reign in the hearts of our cities and our towns, that arms would be laid down, that groups who hate each other for no good reason, and often silly reasons like religion or the color of their skin, when all world religions have basically the same kind of values of love, of hospitality, of peace, and of worship. Quiet hearts, open minds, and may we live together in peace around the world. Amen. Let's read responsively our call to worship. Here in this place, there are no foreigners. Here in this worship, there is only acceptance. Here in our lives, there are no divisions. Come, let us worship in unity and love. Let's turn in our hymnals or look to the screen and sing together All the Way My Savior Leads Me. Let's pray together. God of secrets, purposes, and extravagant blessings, we come to praise you. We come because we want to. We sing our songs because we are glad to. We pray for your grace because we need to. and we ask for the love of Christ, because without it, we are a dead loss. Lift every shutter within our mind and open all the doors of our souls, that you may come in through Christ Jesus, the joy of loving hearts. Amen. That was a great parade. Weston? Is Grandpa going to come with you? Yeah, you could use some Sunday school. So. Just kidding. Now who's, Kristen, are you? Who's teaching Sunday school? Lori, okay. All right, I'm going to pray for you, and you guys are going to go out and learn more about Palm Sunday, okay? I don't know. Maybe palms. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank you for Weston and for all the children of our congregation. We pray that you would bless him and Lori today as they talk about what Palm Sunday really means. Thank you for the great song that we we could parade to, and we ask that our hearts would be as open and joyful as those who were there so many years ago. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, give me a high five. All right, future leader of the Rose Parade. Yes, Will. Talk later? Yeah, we can. Let's lift our joys and our challenges to God. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, we thank you for our gathering today. We thank you for such beautiful music that lifts our hearts and feeds our soul. We thank you, even though there's snow on the ground, we see the bright sunshine glimmering off the canal, and we are blessed, and we feel the warmth on our faces and know that you make all things new once again. We praise you, O God, because you are a God of love and grace and welcome and compassion. Help us emulate those and all the qualities that you embody. Help us to be faithful followers of Jesus and affect the world in the positive way that he did so long ago. We want to lift up other congregations as they do the same, and we lift up specifically Millgrove United Church. We pray that you would bless this rural church. I think it's just outside of Hamilton. And we pray that you would bless this congregation and its leaders, that they would be a light in a place of maybe not darkness, but certainly not the kind of light that you project onto our paths. May it be a place of love, of unconditional love and acceptance. Bless them, O God, that they might be a blessing to the community around them. We want to lift up Wesley, and they've had such a journey in the last few years, waiting for the right minister to come. And we thank you that you brought Lennox to Welland, and we pray that you would help him to heal quickly, but also that he would have the patience to go back when he's ready. We know that we ministers like to do things on our timetable, but we pray that he would submit to your timetable, O God, and that you would just heal him perfectly and bless Wesley. Help us to keep them in our prayers and do whatever we can to help them carry their burden while their minister is getting better. We pray for, we've heard on the news, whether we're monarchists or not, the cancer diagnosis for King Charles and for Princess Catherine. And we know that this disease is insidious. It is no respecter of humans. It doesn't matter if we're rich or poor, part of aristocracy, or just a common, ordinary person. Cancer has touched all of us here today. Maybe not personally, but someone close. So we pray for healing. We pray for good medical care, early diagnosis, and we pray that we would do our part in all the screenings that we have available to us here in Ontario, that instead of putting it off and putting it off, we would do them diligently, because we also know that early detection is often the key to recovery. So we pray healing for all who are battling cancer, and we ask that you would give them courage and stamina as they undergo all the chemicals that are needed to take care of this disease. We have other brothers and sisters who have needs, and you know those needs, O God. We pray for Cindy and Dawn and Barb, for Dave and Madeline, for Scott and Sarah and Sean, for Amy, Andrew, Harold, and Brian. We want to lift up Barb especially, as she has gone back into hospital with some complications from her kidney surgery. And we thank you for a quick diagnosis, but we pray for a complete healing there as well. Oh God, you have bound us together in friendship, in love, in grace, and kindness towards one another. We thank you for all that brings us together. We think of the old hymn that says, bind us together. bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. And one of those cords is our common faith and prayer that you gave us, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We thank you for the gifts that you have brought, and we dedicate them to our Lord. O God, we thank you as you provide all our needs. You provided manna in the desert. You provide our daily bread each and every day that we might live. May we be good stewards of all that you have entrusted to us and use them to your glory, honor, and the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's turn in our hymnals or look to the screen and sing together, O Jesus, I Have Promised. Our scripture reading for this morning is from Ruth chapter 1, verses 1 to 18. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. So a man from Bethlehem in Judea, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech, his wife's name was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem, Judah, and they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and Naomi was left without her sons and her husband. When Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, she and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there. With her two daughters-in-law, she left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her two daughters-in-laws, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show you kindness, as you have shown kindness to your dead husbands and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them goodbye, and they wept aloud and said to her, "We will go back with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons who would become your husbands? Return home, my daughters. I am too old to have another husband. Even if I thought there was still hope for me, even if I had a husband tonight and then gave birth to sons, would you wait until they grew up? Would you remain unmarried for them? No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has turned against me." At this they wept aloud again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. "Look," said Naomi, "your sister-in-law is going back to her people and her gods. Go back with her." But Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me." When Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. Now our second reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 10. Then Peter began to speak. "I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him up from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name. Holy wisdom, holy word. As we come to the conclusion of our Lenten series and discuss family relationships, and it's been a really good series, by the way. I've really enjoyed it anyway. We look at the story of Ruth and her mother-in-law, Naomi. It's a story that shows how God moves in mysterious ways his wonders to perform. It's a story for people who wonder where God is when there are no dreams or visions or prophets. It's for people who wonder where God is when one tragedy after another attacks their faith. It's a story for people who wonder whether a life of integrity in tough times is worth living. It's a story for people who can't imagine that anything great could could ever come out of their ordinary lives. It's a refreshing and encouraging book, and I want you to be refreshed as we come to Holy Week. According to chapter 1, verse 1, the story took place during the time of the judges. This was a 400-year period after Israel entered the promised land under Joshua and before there were any kings in Israel. The book of Judges comes just before Ruth in our English Bibles, and you can see from its very last verse what sort of period it was. Judges chapter 21 tells us, in those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Sounds a little anarchy to me. It was a dark time in Israel's history. The people would turn from God. Enemies would conquer them. The people would cry out for help. Help us, O Lord. And God would mercifully raise up a judge or a leader to deliver them. The cycle repeats itself time and time again. And what the book of Ruth does for us is gives us a glimpse of the hidden work of God during the worst of times. The verse in Ruth 4:22 tells us that the child is born to Ruth and Boaz. So we're skipping ahead. We're going to come back in a second. During the time of the judges. And his name is Obed. And Obed becomes the father of Jesse. And Jesse becomes the father of David, who led Israel to her greatest heights of glory. One of the main messages in the book of Ruth is that God is at work in the worst of times. In spite of the shortcomings of Israel, God can turn things around. It was true at the national level, and we will see that it is true at the personal family level too. God is at work in the worst of times. Verses 1 to 5 describe the misery of Naomi. There was a famine in Judah where Naomi and her husband Elimelech and her sons lived. They decided to sojourn to Moab, a pagan land with foreign gods. Now, God had called his people to be separate from the surrounding land. So when Naomi's husband dies, what could she feel but the judgment of God that had followed her and added to her grief and the famine? Then her two sons take Moabite wives, one named Orpah and the other named Ruth. And again, tragedy. Verse 5 sums up Naomi's tragedy. Both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman had lost her two sons and her husband. A famine, a move to a pagan Moab, the death of her husband, the marriage of her sons to foreign wives, and the death of her sons. Blow after blow, tragedy after tragedy. Now what? Then a glimmer of hope. Naomi gets word that the Lord has visited the people and given them food. So she decides to return to Judah. Her two daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah, by the way, and this is free of charge, I'm not charging you anything for this little extra nugget. Legend has it that Oprah Winfrey's name was supposed to be Orpah, but whoever filled out her birth certificate spelled it incorrectly, and she became Oprah. Like I said, has nothing to do with the sermon, just a little nugget of trivia that might come in handy next year when we have trivia night. So her two daughter-in-laws, Ruth and Orpah, go with her partway, but then she tries to persuade them to go back home. And I think there's a few reasons why the writer devotes so much space to Naomi's effort to get Ruth and Orpah to go back to their own home. First, we really see a glimpse of Naomi's misery. She said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am old, too old, to have a husband." In other words, Naomi feels she has absolutely nothing to offer her daughters-in-law. second reason involves a custom in Israel, which is going to turn everything around for Naomi in the following chapters. The custom was that when an Israelite husband died, his brother or near relative was to marry the widow and continue the brother's name. Naomi is referring to this custom when she says she has no sons to marry Ruth and Orpah. She forgets that there's another relative named Boaz who might perform the duty of a brother. There's a reminder here. When things are difficult in our lives, when we usually exaggerate our hopelessness. When things are going bad, we kind of like to wallow in it a little bit, and we can easily kind of take a poor me attitude. We can become so bitter, we can't see the rays of light peeping out around the clouds. It was God who broke the famine and opened the way home. It was God who preserved a kinsman redeemer to continue Naomi's line. And it was God who constrains Ruth to stay with her mother-in-law, with Naomi. But Naomi is so self-absorbed and embittered by God's hard providence, she can't see God's mercy at his work. The third reason is the beauty of Ruth's faithfulness to Naomi. Verse 14 says that Orpah kissed Naomi goodbye, but Ruth clung to her, just held on. Not even another entreaty in verse 15 can get Ruth to leave. This is all the more amazing after Naomi's grim description of their future together. Ruth stays with her mother-in-law in spite of an apparently hopeless future of widowhood and childlessness. Naomi paints the future black. There's nothing attractive about going back to Judah. But Ruth took her hand and walked into it with her. Ruth's response was, "Don't urge me to leave. Don't urge me to leave you or turn back from you. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me." The more you think about these words, the more amazing they become. Ruth's commitment to her destitute mother-in-law is simply astonishing. It means leaving her own family and her own land, her own customs, her own religion. And for any of you who have left home, maybe a home that you loved, you know how Ruth was feeling. It means, as far as she knows, a life of widowhood and hope and childlessness, because Naomi has no man to give. And if she married a non-relative, her commitment to Naomi's family would be lost and be severed. She is seemingly stuck with a tough life ahead. It means she's going to an unknown land with new people and new customs, a new language. It was a commitment even more radical than marriage. Where you die, I will die, and there be buried. In those words, she will never return home, not even if Naomi dies. But the most amazing commitment of all of this is, "Your God will be my God." Naomi has just said, "The hand of the Lord has gone forth against me." Naomi's experience of God was bitterness. But in spite of this, Ruth forsakes her religious heritage and makes the God of Israel her God. Perhaps she had made that commitment years before, when her husband told her of the great love of God for Israel and his power at the Red Sea and his glorious purpose of peace and righteousness. Somehow or other, Ruth had come to trust in Naomi's God, in spite of Naomi's lack of faith. Here we have the picture of an amazing, faithful, and godly woman. Faith in God that sees beyond the present setbacks. Freedom from the securities and comforts of the world. Courage to venture into the unknown and the strange. radical commitment in the relationship appointed by God. So what do we learn from the example of Ruth and her devotion and commitment to her mother-in-law? Someone who was not like her, who looked different, who was other. God, our Creator, reigns. God rules the nations, and He rules His families. His providence extends from Parliament Hill to your kitchen. God gives rain and He takes rain. He gives life and He takes life. In Him we live and move and we have our being. God's providence can be hard. God had dealt bitterly with Naomi, at least in the short run. It could feel like bitterness. Neither the Old Testament nor the New Testament promises that believers will escape affliction in this life. Like the old country song said, God doesn't promise us a rose garden. But in all of God's work and His purposes are for good and happiness of His people. Maybe we've got to keep an eye on the long run. Who would have imagined that in the worst times of all, the period of the judges, God was quietly moving the tragedies of a single family to prepare the way for the greatest king of Israel? You see, if we studied the rest of the book, we would find that that Ruth did find a husband within the family, and that this man would be the grandfather of the greatest king of Israel, David, and that this king of Israel would foreshadow the King of Kings, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Now, I know today is not your typical Palm Sunday service when we talk about the journey of Jesus into Jerusalem and people cheering Him on with palm branches and singing, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. However, it's a journey. And a journey I encourage that you ask yourselves, do you have the faithfulness of Ruth when the journey is hard and unknown, or the fickleness of the crowds? Ruth promised her life to Naomi and God, and God put this foreign woman into the direct lineage of Jesus. Now many of those who stood by the road and shouted Hosanna were part of the crowd that later shouted, crucify Him, crucify Him. And that crowd was mostly Jesus's people. As we look at this passage today, if we trust in the sovereign goodness and mercy of God to pursue us, then we, like Ruth, are free. When we believe in the sovereignty of God and that He loves to work mightily for His children, it gives a freedom and a joy that can't be shaken by hard times. The book of Ruth gives us a glimpse into the hidden work of God during what in our lives may feel like the worst of times. And so, like all other scriptures, as Paul says in Romans 15, Ruth was written that we might abound in hope. Let's look to the screen as the choir leads us and we sing When We Are Tested.
Thank you.
reminder that everyone is welcome downstairs for a time of fellowship and refreshment. And I neglected to mention Friday, very important day, Good Friday. Our service, our joint service with Wesley and Fenwick and Font Hill will happen right here at 10 o'clock on Friday morning. So I hope to see you there. And now receive this blessing. Let us go into this holy week in trusting in the grace of God. When our strength fails and we descend into dread, may we still find the courage to turn toward the cross, to our King who wears a crown of thorns, and serve his world with compassion. Go and remember that all our lives are held in God's gracious, omnipotent hand.